What's up, everybody, and welcome to another Rebel Ranks, and today we'll be going over the best levels in Spyro 3 Year of the Dragon, which coincidentally, it's just the 16 main levels in Spyro 3 Year of the Dragon.
You want a piece of me, Reinach boy?
Ah, Spyro. The level design in these games is the biggest reason why these were my favorite games growing up, and I'm not giving anything away from which is my favorite because level design is only one part of the game, but Spyro 3 has, in my opinion, the best level design in the trilogy. So ranking them ended up being pretty tough, both for the best and the worst. Well, minus the flying levels. Actually, my ranking ended up basically having all the main levels in the top half, with the other stages all essentially being ranked worst in general. On the best half, only three ended up being an SBC level or a hub, so here's how I'm gonna do this. I'm just gonna rank all the non-Spyro levels and hubs in the worst video, and the groups I rank these in will also be best to worst, and the first half will literally just be the main 16 levels, which makes sense to me. So smash that like button, subscribe, and let's get on with it.
And I did mention this in the worst half, but in case you didn't see that, which is unlikely, everyone always views the worst half and rarely the best half, these first four levels were levels that would have been in the worst half of the game anyway.
Number 16, Frozen Altars. And yes, this is, in my opinion, the worst main level in Spyro 3. I also think it's a pretty good level. This is how hard this is. Even the worst levels are pretty good. Anyways, the beam you need to melt the snow melts pretty slow, and it's kind of annoying. Your flame breath is replaced with an ice breath, so you freeze your enemies. However, what that also means is your flame is now not even really an attack. So if you flame an enemy, you'll still have to charge them. I do like the idea of frozen enemies becoming platforms, but maybe if freezing them the first time then gave you the gem from them dying without having to actually kill them the second time. Something where I don't have to double attack the same people all throughout the level, whatever. And the level is a decent size, but do take into account that there are no bonus areas in this level, the two challenges being boxing and hockey. The song also doesn't really fit the level. I mean, I don't see it fitting the game much either, but I don't. The only thing I really do like about this level would be the platforming across the tops of the walls and the buildings. That's pretty neat. Number 15, Molten Crater, and I almost had this level in last. However, I did look back at everything, and due to the boxing, cat hockey, and the very out of place song, Molten Crater moved up a spot. And yes, this level is pretty short. It might be the shortest level, in fact, but the Sergeant Bird section, which isn't the worst, is a decent size. And the supercharge area is kind of nice. Not chasing the thieves, but the area itself. Yeah, just a pretty lackluster level. Still really do like the ambiance, though. Number 14, Enchanted Towers. A pretty decent level. I do like going through the towers. The enemies are pretty annoying, though. I always try to get them before they get into the air so I don't have to spit lava rocks at them, because that's annoying. I do also dig the area for returning that dude's dog challenge, and the skate park here might be the best skate park in the game. As for the Sergeant Bird section, I'm not the biggest fan. It's cool to explore a Spyro level with not Spyro, but it also just seems sort of lazy. So this level does have a lot going for it, however there's just something about this level that I don't really enjoy. The skate park is sick though. Might be enough to bump this level up, but I don't know. Number 13, Seashell Shore. And this is another level I never really look forward to, but always enjoy when I do play it. The level does a nice switch from underwater to above ground and underwater again pretty nicely. There's a short little Sheila section. I'm not a huge fan of the tunnel eggs, but I do really enjoy the mini boss challenge. I also dig hiding gems underwater in an area where at first you're only allowed to moto surf on. Pretty decent level with nothing wrong. Just nothing at all that makes it stand out. Number 12, Bamboo Terrace, and this level looks really nice. I do like the aesthetic, but I will say this level is pretty wide open in some parts, which kind of leads to it seeming somewhat empty. It is a decent sized level though, and through the main section, nothing really amazing here. Getting the question mark jar is cool. There is a bonus section where you shoot fireballs while on a boat. Doesn't add anything to the level, honestly. There's a Bentley section that is actually a decent size. It would be a lot cooler if Bentley wasn't so infuriating to control. Number 11, Cloud Spires, a level that I really do enjoy the platforming in, but the overall aesthetic, yeah, not so much. I don't know what it is, but I'm just not really a fan. I do like exploring this level, I just don't like what I'm looking at while doing so. And it isn't bad or anything, I don't know. It's not the architecture so much as the color palette. Yeah, I don't know. At the end of the level are two bonus sections, both being somewhat explorable, which is always better than something on rails. Neither section is that remarkable though. The best thing about this level is realizing that halfway through was a base for a whirlwind, and after finishing the level, it's back up. It takes you up and around, up on the big structure in the middle for some gems, as well as an egg. It is honestly the best part of the level.
And with that, we reach the top 10 levels in Spyro 3, and all of these levels have something amazing about them. But the next 5 also have something incredibly lame to even it out, so let's get into number 10.
Number 10, Sunny Villa, essentially the first level in the game, and it's pretty cool. I dig the Roman aesthetic. That egg that you have to get to by gliding on the tops of the tall pillars is dope. The rest of the level is pretty short though. Like, it's up here, around here, down here, and boom. There is one of the skate park sections here, and it's pretty good. Not as good as the park in Enchanted Towers, but still. There's also a Sheila section here, and it's pretty fun. Focusing on the double jumps and whatnot. Always enjoy this section. And I always enjoy this level when I start a new game. It is just a little bit too short though. Number 9, Lost Fleet, and man, this level can be pretty fun. It could also be pretty maddening. The main section of this level is pretty great. I love the aesthetic here. There isn't anything specific to point out, it's all really good. There are these cannons throughout the level, and you have to shoot down all of these birds, and that can be annoying because they just disappear behind stuff. The subsection isn't too bad. There's this great idea of giving invincibility at the end to swim through toxic waters. It's pretty awesome. Except that it runs out super fast and you'll be going back to the power-up gate a couple times. Great idea though. Oh, there's a skating race here and it's terrible. Number 8, Charmed Ridge, and man, this level gives me some serious Spyro 1 vibes, Magic Crafters style, and I love it. The whole layout and design, the moving platforms are great, the ending section is great, the cat that drops the pillar on you sucks. There's a bonus section with Sergeant Bird that's just a circle and you shoot cat wizards, so nothing here level-wise really, but then there's this bonus section that gives me serious Spyro 2 vibes from like Zephyr. It's Jack and his beanstalk, and it's great, amazing puzzle solving here, and even in a bonus section they hide gems so well with this cracked floor to head patch. It's oh my god, it's so good. Number 7, Spooky Swamp, and I always liked this level as a kid, not sure why. Still can't pinpoint it. The aesthetic is pretty cool. The water doesn't just damage you like normally, so you have a grace period in the water before the piranhas attack, which can make for a few nail-biting moments as well as some awesome shortcuts by cutting corners. And also, there's a mini-boss here, which is actually pretty neat. The only downside the level has going for it is the Sheila section where these stupid dum-dums keep blowing themselves up, but even that area has some nice wall caves. Number 6, Icy Peak, a very fun level, minus these annoying TNT rats. Also, like Lost Fleet, there are cannons you need to use to shoot down birds for gems. However, this level is more linear and doesn't intertwine on itself, so it's actually pretty good. Besides that, the cannons will break ice walls throughout the level to progress as well as get some gems and eggs. There's this area with a crack in the ice. I do know it's reachable from the edge, but I'll get back to this. A little later, you'll see some more gems underwater, and there's no clear way to get them. I loved that as a kid. There's a bonus section with the figure skater. Doesn't add to anything though. There's a bonus section that does add some cool stuff with a supercharged loop, and it also has a breakable wall and a hidden cave with a whirlwind. And getting to the end of this level unlocks the route which leads to the high cave, which you can ground pound the ice here and get all of these underwater gems, as well as to this whirlwind you couldn't reach before to get to this egg out on this pillar. All in all, very nice level. But damn, those TNT rats are pretty annoying.
And with that, we reached the top 5 levels in Spyro 3, and I don't know if you've noticed, but I haven't listed a single level from Midnight Mountain. Which means 4 of the 5 levels in the top 5 are levels from Midnight Mountain. And number 5.
Number 5, Haunted Tomb, such a cool level. I do love the Egyptian tomb theme here. Yeah, Crash 3. And the enemies here are pretty cool as well. These giants throw fireballs or something at you. I don't know, after it lands, you can pick them up and use them to break these caskets, which is pretty cool. I will say this level is way too short though. It might actually be a decent length, but it's just so cool that I just kind of want more of it. One of the bonus sections is a tank fight, which is cool, but it doesn't really add anything to the level. There's a section with Agent 9 as well, but it's just some rooms with enemies. And lastly, a slide. It's really nothing special. It's pretty short of a slide. And as much as I really do love this level, I will admit it could have been so much more. Number 4, Crystal Islands, and as the name implies, this level is floating islands, covered in crystal. There are two different enemies here that are both made in crystal, and you need to flame both of them. There's also these flying bats, and you'll need to flame them as well, so no enemies that you can actually charge, minus the octopus underwater. I guess I do like the blend of the little tiny underwater sections between the main flying sections from island to island. I will say it is rather annoying that the NPCs use magic to create a temporary path to help you move forward. If you're trying to get everything, you're not going to need the path yet, but they still just start talking to you right when you show up. It happens like 3 times throughout the level. I don't know, it's annoying. Then once you get to the end of the level, there is a cool sliding mini section that's a lot bigger than the one in Haunted Tombs, by the way. There is a Bentley mini game section area where you have to play whack-a-mole. There is actually gems all the way down at the bottom, so you will have to walk really, really slowly all the way down to get everything. There's also a flying power-up gate that you use to catch a flying egg thief, as well as get some other gems, another egg, and a key for a locked chest. The egg is the first thing you see, and getting it takes away your flying power-up, so you won't be able to reach the key if you went for the egg first, which is really annoying. But besides that, and needing to talk to the NPCs multiple times for a path forward, this is such an awesome level. Number 3, Desert Ruins, and just like the last two, and the next two, the theme here is just so good. The ruins are so well placed, the enemies here are cool as well, scorpions and statue things that breathe fire. There's that arm on the side of the rocks with a key, and I missed it my first time, and seeing it and knowing there's a secret there somewhere, oh, it's awesome. And there are two jumps here that utilize the ruins and platforms as well, the second one leading to an egg, and from there glide into this cave for another egg, along with a breakable wall to get the aforementioned key. There's also a Sheila section here, a 2D scroller. It's pretty fun, but nothing that really adds to the level. This last room area leads to an underwater section with Hunter and his manta ray. It's okay. Also a hidden little platform here with a pink 25 gem made me scratch my head as a kid, like how did I miss that much? Oh, and then the rat, it's Lara Croft. Tara Croft. Yeah. Number 2, Dino Mines. And man, as a kid, this theme was amazing. I loved cowboys and dinosaurs, understandably so for a 9-year-old. Anyways, hit an egg right away. You can see this gem, kind of, so, you know, there's your hint. And yeah, I will say that while this level is a little on the linear side and doesn't have anything crazy on the side of platforming, there is an increase in the challenge due to the enemies in this level. Very tough. There is this underwater section, nice hidden egg here. There's a mini section that's swimming down a tunnel. It's pretty lame. And an Asian 9 section that's kind of like an on rails FPS, like one of those Dave and Buster's arcade games. And while that normally wouldn't add much to the level, you can just explore this area after you've beaten it, where you can get some gems that you missed, as well as this hidden egg. Genius, man. Oh, and you have to burn cactus to get all of the gems. I don't know about that. And I'm pretty sure I heard a rumor that this level is supposed to be bigger, which, oh my god, that just would have made it so much better.
Yes, all 4 Midnight Mountain levels, they are just so amazing, and this is always my favorite part of the game to get to. However, that does leave just one level, and coming in at number 1,
Fireworks Factory. Man, what an amazing level. The theme, of course, is awesome. Greta and Handel return from Spyro 2. There are enemy boxes on the edges, meaning that those ninjas keep spawning. It's so good. There's an egg, and it isn't too well hidden, but coming back this way as how I realize that there are gems in here. There's a part where you have to get shot by a cannon, and Greta just somehow clears the gap like nothing. Hilarious. From there, you can start destroying enemy boxes for gems. There's a mini section for an egg through this cave. It's amazing and long and really adds to the level. There's a mini boss where you fight 2 dragons. Hey, wait, no, you're a dragon. Those aren't
what?
And then there's this Doom-inspired Agent 9 section, and oh, wow, so good. It is a little like the Spyro Cave section, but it doesn't matter that it's similar because it is just so good and flushes out the level so much, and along with everything else this level has to offer, makes it the best level in Spyro 3.
Yes, Fireworks Factory is the best level in the game, in my opinion, and I'm not sure what the general consensus is. I didn't want any outside influence, but I have a feeling this has got to be like the best level in the game, according to other people. If not, it's got to be the top five. I mean, come on, this level's just epic. And that's going to wrap this one up. Like, subscribe, comment your favorite level, all of that good stuff. Hey, share this video with somebody else who loves Spyro, because I mean, I could use a little extra assistance helping boost my channel a little bit. So at the very least, just, you know, drop a like. Next time we got the worst eggs, the best eggs, just a few of them. There's 150. I'm not going to talk about all of them. That would be ludicrous and a complete waste of my time to try to rank them towards the middle. I'll just be looking at the worst and the best. And until next time, peace.